G'day, DickSmith here.
I love Dick.
This is a story about one of Australia's most iconic Aussies, DickSmith. Dick started out as a businessman and through his success became an adventurer, travelling the world and breaking world records. He is now a philanthropist. In this documentary, we will explore the life and legacy of Dick Smith, the businessman, adventurer, and philanthropist. This is Australia. Richard Harold Smith, commonly known to all Australians as Dick Smith, was born on the 18th of March 1944 into a family of two kids. His dad was a salesman and his mum a homemaker. Dick says he was always a free-range kid, so he could go run around exploring life. Dick didn't like school and struggled with dyslexia, but he loved the outdoors. He joined the Boy Scouts, which taught him one of his major life lessons.
I learned leadership, and I learned that you could be an individual. I was never a patrol leader or a sixth or in cards or anything like that. I was never that good in those days, but I realised that I could go out adventuring.
Dick didn't start out as successful as you would think. Struggling at school, he chose against university and to start up his own business after spending a few years working in a factory. Dick's mum and dad were concerned that he would be working in a factory for the rest of his life, but Dick proved them all wrong.
And there's a store near you.
In 1968, Dick, with his fiancée Pip, opened their first retail store with only $610 in the bank. The store was Dick Smith Electronics in Sydney's Neutral Bay. It started out by selling car radios and went on to become Australia's largest electronics chain. How did he become so successful? What were some of the challenges of managing all 50 stores?
Well, that's the difference between a small business person and someone who can run a larger business. It's putting in systems. And I was very good at putting systems in place so each shop could be replicated. And so even though we called the person who ran the shop a manager, they weren't actually managing that much because I managed the place from the head office. I had a system called Dick's Video, which everyone would think was common today with video, but it was one of the very first when we had VHS tapes. And every 2 weeks I'd do a video show and I'd ask the staff, should we buy this particular component? And I'd give the features. And then all of the staff, I think about 500 staff all around Australia, would vote on whether we should buy the product or not. And that made it inspired everyone. They were part of the decision-making process.
He sold his flourishing chain to Woolworths for over $25 million. Was it a hard decision to sell your business?
No. It's amazing. When people see Dick Smith Electronics today, they think, that's me. Well, of course it isn't. I sold that business. No, it was the best thing I ever did. I had enough money and I wanted to spend more time with my family and to go adventuring. And I've never regretted it for one second. I'm really proud that 40 years later it still exists. But I love creating something. I'm not very good at running it. I don't have a long attention span. Mm-hmm. And so once a business is running level, I didn't want to keep expanding it. I'm against that for reasons no doubt we'll discuss soon. And so I just wanted to keep it level. And I thought other people can run this. And so I moved into something else.
After this chapter in his life, Dick did something that I found amazing. He was the first person to pilot a helicopter all around the world. Alone. Here, I'll show you. So he went from Australia and then he went all around the world back to Australia. He then went via the poles, so down to Antarctica, up to the Arctic, and then back down to Australia.
This exciting adventure was solo around the world by helicopter because I was very inexperienced. A solo adventure is quite frightening because you're by yourself and I was frightened a lot of the time. I only had one engine, and if the engine failed across the Atlantic Ocean, I would probably be drowned. I did have a little life jacket on. That was the theory. I'd be floating around, someone would come and get me. Also, in those days, the Soviet Union existed and the Cold War, and you couldn't land in Russia. That's why no one had flown around the world. So I had to land on a ship to refuel between Japan and Alaska. And it was before GPS for navigation. So I had difficulty in finding the ship, and then the ship's rocking around, and took me 2 hours to refuel. And I only just got into the island at the end of the Aleutian chain, Alaska. So that was the day I was very frightened, and I was very lucky to get away with that and still be alive.
After Dick completed his flight around the world, other adventurers attempted their own death-defying feats, like Richard Branson. He tried going across the Atlantic in the fastest time. Unfortunately for him, his boat, the Virgin Atlantic Challenger, capsized, and he had to be rescued by the British RAF. Shortly after that, there was a major controversy in Australia. They were trying to dam the World Heritage listed Franklin River in Tasmania. So Dick went down there to support this blockade. This was a very pivotal moment for him.
I was involved in something called the Franklin River Blockade. It was actually a blockade to try and stop a big dam on the Gordon River in Tasmania. And I went down there and the media said, oh, here's Dick Smith, he's just here for the publicity. And they didn't realise that as a Boy Scout, I'd bushwalked in Tasmania, I'd mountain climbed, I'd rock climbed in Tassie, and I loved the place. And so I suddenly thought, oh, I've got to change my image. And I thought the best way of changing the image was to start a magazine like Canadian Geographic and show that I was interested in the environment.
In 1986, Dick became Australian of the Year.
I think it was a bit after I flew around the world by helicopter, so I was quite well known because of that. And I was starting to help with philanthropy, trying to help with charitable concerns. And I was absolutely surprised one day when the telephone rang and I said, hello. And this lady said, I'm from the Australia Day Committee, Mr. Smith. She called me Mr. Smith, always very suspicious. Most people call me Dick. I thought, what's this about? She'd called from Canberra. Wow. And she said, look, we're wondering if you would accept the appointment of Australian of the Year. And I thought it was one of my friends who were joking, but it was the truth. So I was excited. Now, it didn't really help with business at all, but it helped with what I could do with charitable concerns and motivating people to do good things. I've had great pleasure in giving a lot of the money away, and by the time I die, I agree with Bill Gates. The money's not going to go to my two daughters or our two daughters. Most of it's going to be given away to charity. They're going to have to make their own way.
1986 was looking to be a great year for Dick. After becoming Australian of the Year, he founded Australian Geographic. Australian Geographic is a magazine and a shop which he founded because he felt he wanted to share his love for Australia. Each year, a portion of the profits goes to Australian Geographic Society, which supports Australian research and Australian community groups. Dick then sold this thriving business to Australian-owned John Fairfax Publications in 1995. Most people would be pretty content by this time in their life, but not old Dick, because he was the first person to balloon flight across the Australian continent in 1993. Dick's love for aviation was recognised by the Civil Aviation Authority because he was made chairman of the board in 1990. He is also currently a patron of the Australian Aviation Museum in Bankstown.
We've made, I think, about $7 million out of Dick Smith Foods in 13 years. All of that's been donated. It's a charitable concern. I was motivated by an American film star called Paul Newman. And he had this salad dressing that he'd invented, and all his friends wanted to buy it. And so one day he said, well, look, let's start manufacturing and we'll give all the profits to charity. And I thought, wow, I could do the same thing in Australia, but have a different angle. I could say, we're just going to sell food that is grown in Australia and processed by Australian-owned companies. And that's what we did. We've turned over about $400 million, so that's kept a lot of jobs here on farms. And we've been able to give about $7 million to charity, so it makes me feel good.
His products suffer from heavy competition with established brands and rarely occupy prime positions on the supermarket shelves. So join me and buy DickSmith Foods because, well, it's really yummy. But not all mums and dads will listen to that when it's a little bit more expensive. So all you need to tell them is this and they will buy it. DickSmith Food products are 100% made in Australia. Unlike Kraft peanut butter. Kraft peanut butter is from nuts that are in South America. unlike Osnuts. The next reason is because DickSmith Foods has turned over $400 million, which means it's kept a lot of Aussie jobs, and all the profits go to charity.
This is the most important thing I've ever done in my life. It's incredible because I've done very well out of Australia, but I see terrible problems coming for future generations, and I don't want them to look back and say, well, people like Dick Smith, they were supposed to be influential. Why didn't they do anything? And I'm going to spend the rest of my life trying to get a proper policy, not just for Australia, but for the world, on population. So we know that, using that terrible word sustainable, we know that we can live for thousands of years on this earth in balance, not completely ruin it. So, in effect, people are going to starve in the future.
So you created this book and this movie, The Dick Smith Population Crisis and Dick Smith Population Puzzle.
One of the best written books in the world, I think.
I know, but I've watched the movie a few times and I've almost read the whole book. So what made you write a book and make a movie?
Well, it was a very important thing because most capitalists, I'm a capitalist, just want growth. They want perpetual growth in population, perpetual growth in profits. But I knew one of the reasons I sold Dick Smith Electronics when I was only 39 years of age is because I realised something said to me, you can't grow forever. Everything in nature lives in balance, everything other than humans, that is. And at the moment, my friends, my capitalistic friends, all say we have to have bigger and bigger Australia, more and more people. And I've said to them, hold on, when we have a trillion people in Sydney, will that be too many? And then they have to laugh and have to admit to me that there is a limit to growth. At the moment, we have 4 million in Sydney. Everyone wants it to go to 8 million, maybe then 16 million, 30 million. Our quality of life goes. And I believe that we should live in balance like everything in nature does. If you look at the beautiful wild creatures, it might be the one I love is the Major Mitchell parrot, absolutely beautiful. The quantity that are around now have been the same for probably a million years. They just live in balance. Human beings should live in balance. At the moment, we're going to go to 10 billion people. And I don't believe there's going to be enough food around to feed 10 billion people properly. And that really worries me. I think every human being should be well fed, should be able to be warm at night, and should be able to have a nice family environment and not have to work all the time.
But there are loads of people just like today that don't have enough food and aren't warm or...
Yeah, and that's the reason why I think we've got to even start reducing the population now. So we have about 2 billion people in this world of the 7 billion who are close to starving. They live on less than $5 a day. I think that's bad. And I just have a feeling that by having more people, it will make it worse. And in fact, Julia Gillard said they had a Minister for Sustainable Population but did nothing, because you'd have to be a very game politician to doubt growth.
People are not thinking about what's going to happen in the middle of the century when there is going to be a colossal confrontational clash between human needs and the ability of the planet to supply those.
Food prices, housing affordability, traffic congestion, overcrowded concrete jungles, carbon emissions, all of these things come back ultimately to population.
It's just a limited amount of resources in this land that we're standing on. You can't squeeze these rocks and get food out of them. It's just not going to work. And the rest of the world is doing the same sort of a thing and then turning to Australia and saying, well, we need more food as well. You guys have to feed more people in the rest of the world whose populations are running out of control.
Dick is spending the rest of his life trying to educate as many people as he can about unsustainable population growth. Even I understand that this issue is not just an Aussie issue, but a worldwide problem. Our Earth has been struggling a lot recently. I have watched and read a large amount of things starting with Dick's video. The situation is getting worse day by day. Fossil fuel use is growing around the world. The world needs an example to show that we cannot grow forever in a finite world, and I believe that Australia should be that example.
Australia's population cannot continue to increase indefinitely, but I can't find anywhere what the politicians' plans are for a sustainable Australia. No one seems to be talking about it. Unless we deal with the population crisis now, we will find ourselves overpopulated, and then be dealing with the crisis.
I have a petition for all Australians to sign and another one for the world. When Mr. Abbott was my age, the population of Australia was about 11 million. Now it has more than doubled at 23 million, and many politicians say it should double again. When I'm his age, in 2060, what should the country's population be? Please sign my petition if you agree that Mr. Abbott should tell us what Australia's population is going to be in 2060. I would also like the Leader of the Opposition, Mr. Bill Shorten, to answer my question as well. Today, the global population is 7 billion, and we are heading towards 10 billion in my lifetime. The experts say this will create huge problems with food, water, and pollution. Please sign my petition if you agree that 10 billion should be the absolute maximum. If you agree, then world leaders need to start managing growth so that we don't overpopulate our planet.
Thank you for watching my video on Dick Smith. Please like and subscribe and post your comments below, and don't forget to share this video to your friends so they can be aware of the population issue. Thank you.
Oh, and I almost forgot. I got a helicopter ride with Dick Smith.
Initially, when I started researching this topic, I was bound to find many new things, because all I knew was the store DickSmith Electronics, which I had assumed that he owned. Actually, it was sold 32 years ago to Woolworths, and they have since sold it again. The highlight for me of studying DickSmith is having the opportunity to interview one of Australia's most successful businessmen. I was inspired in the interview by many of the amazing things that he has done. As a society, we can learn many amazing things. He is trying to get the message across to everyone he can that unlimited growth is a very bad thing. At an age where most Australians are retiring, Dick is spending the rest of his time trying to educate as many people as he can about unsustainable population growth. Not just for Australia, but for the rest of the world. This is Australia.